first life group leader training session. And you all are, in a sense, one, people who we know are going to be able to be wonderful life group leaders. But in another sense, you're kind of guinea pigs to a degree, because this is our first go around with this. So be patient with us technologically in the training. But it's going to be a blessing of an afternoon as we look to how life groups are going to help us reach out into our 100-foot circles of influence, to be the hands and feet of Jesus in our community, not only here at Bethlehem, but outside of these walls as well. So this is a neat movement here at Bethlehem that you are on the front end being a part of, and I'm pumped up to be a part of it with you. So let's open up in a time of prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for these, your servants, people who have given of themselves their time, their energy, their talents, Lord, to serve you. We have a lot of better things, Lord, on a Sunday afternoon that we could be doing, but we see the need of being your hands and feet, being people who want to be in relationship with you and with each other, God. And that's why we're here, to see how we can be about making disciples more effectively, God. We love you. Be in this time. May your spirit be present. May everything that is done and said be to your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Creation, what are you here for? What were you created for? What do you think? Anybody? This can be an interactive time. I'm not going to lecture per se, but yeah, what were you created for, do you think?
Praise God.
To praise God. And how do you praise God, Dean? What do you think? In what ways?
Serving.
Through serving others. Love it. Anybody else? Witnessing about what God has done. You were created, I'm here to tell you, you were created to be in relationship both with God, the God of the universe, the one who created you, as well as with fellow created people of Almighty God. This is our calling. There's something innately within us that longs to be in relationship. And when relationship is absent, my goodness, there is a void there, whether it's with God or with others. There is a deep void. We long for relationships. I'm going to say relationship is what you're here for. You are created for a certain sort of life, relationship to God and to people. And I love this right here, represent. You are called to represent God to the rest of creation. Whose image were we created in? The image of God. So we are the representers of God and his holiness, his mercy, his love, his compassion for people. So that's why we have this desire then to be in relationship with others. God got dirty. I love it. God got dirty when he came down into this earth. He created us, right, from dust. He created us from dust, breathed life, his life, his spirit into us. So we have this innate longing to then represent God to the rest of this fallen world. But it is fallen, right? With the fall, much of this full life that we talk about in Jesus Christ was lost. But Scripture, I love this. Scripture can be understood as a story of restoration. God the Father, through the work of the Holy Spirit and the sacrifice of the Son, is restoring humanity to full life. A Father who creates, a Son who redeems, a Spirit who is living within us, making us more and more into the likeness of Jesus Christ, right? And part of being made in the likeness of Jesus, just like Jesus walked, had a group of people that would always gather around him. So we, as followers of Christ, need to be in relationship with other believers or unbelievers. Our calling, if you will, as we work towards this fullness of life, is to make disciples. Make disciples. Make followers of Jesus Christ. That is our calling. So what is this plan of God? What is the calling of a Christian? To be part of God's work. To be part of God's work. And you're at the right place here. Where does God do his thing? He works throughout the rest of humanity. But where, as good Lutherans, do we know that God promises to show up and do his thing? Do what God does, which is save and restore a broken and fallen creation. Where is that? That God does his saving work amongst a group of people whom he uses to do his work. It's nothing mind-blowing. It's not just a place. No, it's a group of people. And what's it called? The church. Yeah, the church. It's the body of Christ, representing Christ, if you will, to the rest of this broken world. And you're here because you have answered this call, if you will, and you want to explore how you can be the hands and feet of Jesus in this community. You want to be God's ambassadors. And I have a question. Does how you spend your time then demonstrate that you're on a mission to restore humanity to its created ideal? Does how you spend your time, work towards advancing the kingdom of God and restoring fullness of life to God's people. And how is this going to happen? How is this fullness of life going to be attained? It's going to be attained by being in relationship with others. I'm pounding on it. So what is it then that defines you? I love this. You live in a relationship to the Father and to all of the people of God on earth. You are, I love, Jesus says this, you are the new Israel, the city on a hill. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. In the same way, let your light shine before men. We are ambassadors for Christ. And a lot of times we can see the church as what? Something we did just this morning, right? That was church. Being church comes here is about coming here and being fed by what God gives, and that's his word and sacrament. And is that important? Is that important? Oh, it's vitally important. But this fullness of life in Jesus is about much more than that. We have the call to be ambassadors now, disciples for Jesus Christ, as a 24/7 endeavor, right? It's not something that you just do on a Sunday morning. It's a lifelong calling, a lifelong vocation to make disciples for Jesus Christ. And that's why you're here. Wherever God takes you, wherever that 100-foot circle of influence is found, there you are called to make disciples. And I'm here to tell you that life groups for a place like Bethlehem are infinitely vital, right? Because apart from being in relationships with smaller groups of people who maybe have like interests, passions, all that kind of stuff with you, apart from being that, it's a very one-sided endeavor in terms of receiving the gifts of God. But we have this innate desire to want to give back gifts and make disciples of Jesus. And that's what life groups are going to allow us to do here as the body of Christ. It's an awesome movement that I'm pumped up that you're going to be a part of. All right, moving on. You are going to be living with people and in front of people. A life group leader picks one area of passion or interest to be intentional with. And life group leaders will seek to form real significant relationships. It's a natural process here. It's nothing that you got to put on a hunky-dory, happy, I'm a Christian and God loves me, smiley, happy face all the time, okay? We want to be real with God's people. Let them know that there are struggles in this life, and we want to walk with them through those struggles. So some good questions for life group leaders as you kind of seek the Spirit's guiding as to what would be a good life group for you. What are some of your passions? What are your interest areas? Some of you may have come today with some life group ideas, and we're going to rally around you and support those ideas. Maybe some of you are still seeking the Spirit's guidance as to where you could best be the hands and feet of Jesus, where you could be most effective to extend his kingdom. Another question here. How could you live life with and in front of people in one of those areas? How could you do that? And I want to show you, I don't know if you've ever heard of this, but there's two ways to look at the Christian life. There's two ways to look at the Christian life, and maybe you're thinking law gospel, and law gospel is going to be a part of this. Uh-oh, did you take my slides out, Sandy? Next one, okay. Well, I'll talk about this. Life group leaders are everyday people, there we go, normal everyday people who have decided to pursue the fullness of life in Christ. Oh, and I can share this right now. Life group leaders are resourced. So what makes this different than any other small group that we've ever had here? You are resourced by what we call zone leaders. People here who want to be a part of your life, get to know you as an individual leader, be there to resource you, pray for you, develop a relationship with you, encourage you in your calling to be a life group leader here at Bethlehem. So we'll serve as a liaison to staff and the ministry teams, this zone leader will. And so that is a neat structure of accountability, if you will, set up right within life groups. So this is the dialogue model of our life of faith. We as Lutherans, we're very, very comfortable with confessing, I'm a poor, miserable sinner. It was my sin that hung Jesus to the cross. And because of that, what do we need? We need forgiveness. So God forgives. And then we know we mess up. We were conceived in sin, born with nothing that can make us right before God. So what do we do on a daily, hour-by-hour, minute-by-minute basis? We're confessing, and God's forgiving. We're confessing, he's forgiving. You like this? There was only this fake diagram I got. It only had five things. So I could, God forgives, you confess, God forgives, you confess, you confess. We confess a lot, right? We as God's people, I couldn't make it work. It was funny. We confess all the time. So this is a dialogue model. Talking to God, receiving from him his blessing, his forgiveness, his love, his restoration, and then going back out and sinning and falling and need to be picked back up again. And God obviously provides that. But there's another diagram model to help us in this walk of faith, if you will. And that looks like this, the journey model of our life of faith. Okay, we are called to make disciples. And yeah, we realize we're poor, miserable sinners and we need Jesus. But as we progress in our faith, there's a change that is evident to other people, right? That they can see this guy is walking with the Lord. He's growing in faith. I can see Jesus in this individual, right? We're loving God and we're loving others like God originally intended in the garden. We're doing that more and more, restoring this broken world to God's original intention. Now, are we going to do it perfectly? No. So we're always using both of these models simultaneously, as a matter of fact. And so I like to, it kind of looks like this. You're confessing, but you're progressing. You know, you're confessing, receiving forgiveness, but you're progressing. The same things you're struggling with right now are things you're getting past as the Holy Spirit enables you and moving on in this journey model of the life of faith. Does that make sense? Any questions about that? So this calling that you're answering right now to be life group leaders as the Spirit enables you, is calling on this journey, on this great journey with the God of the universe to progress in our faith and make disciples for Jesus Christ. Amen? We good? Does that sound good? Yeah, it's our God is good. So let's see here. Are you life group material to wrap up this first little section? God says you are. You're his blood-bought child, right? And he has given his Spirit that lives within you that says you are more than capable to lead God's people, to make disciples. This isn't just a pastor calling or something that only happens on a Sunday. No, you have a calling from Almighty God to interact with saved and unsaved people. People that recognize a need for Jesus and some who have no concept of a need for a Savior, let alone their sin that is so prevalent. You have a calling to make disciples for Jesus. And I'm glad you're here to answer that calling. So now I'm going to ask Sandy to come up, and she's going to share with you. Isn't Sandy awesome, first off? I mean, she does wear so many hats here, and she is so passionate for assimilation, for connecting people and making disciples here at Bethlehem. And she's going to share with you now She's going to share with you seven basic teachings as to what we as life group leaders, as leaders here at this church, are going to profess and teach.
Speaking of awesome, this young man preaches how many times this morning and now decides he's going to hang out with us for a couple of hours and does it with such energy. Whoa. it's good. Small groups here at Bethlehem, life groups, we're calling it right now. It's pretty exciting. I've been around a few years, which is hard to believe because I'm only 29. But I've been around here 25 years, and we've gone through several models of small group ministry here at Bethlehem. I think this wave of the way that we are looking at small groups here can make a difference for a long, long time, for years and years to come. The first wave was really kind of started with a group of people that we'd never done small groups around here at Bethlehem 25 years ago. Meeting in someone's home that was foreign. You came to church, you did Bible study, you went home. And so coming together had to be taught. We had to learn how to do that. So we got a group of people together, we did a Bible study, and then we kind of launched people out into small groups, and it was awesome, it was good. We had great groups that were going. Many of those groups are still meeting today. How many of you are in a group that has been around for a long time? You were in wave two. I haven't talked about your wave yet. You're in second wave. But Daylen, you've been, how long has your group been meeting on Sunday evenings? Yeah, they've been doing it for years and years. Who else has been in? Kim and Ev, you guys have been in a group. John, you were part of that original wave. And Kim, part of that original wave of small groups here at Bethlehem 20, 25 years ago. In recent times, we went to this fall spiritual growth campaign thing. That was probably 5-7 years ago, where the whole congregation started rallying around. Now, Dean, you can raise your hand to that one. That's when your group started meeting and continues to meet today, even though we didn't do a campaign. Well, we did a campaign last year, but we probably won't do a full spiritual growth campaign like we have in the past this year. The fall spiritual growth campaigns were great times for a short period of time for a whole bunch of people in our congregation to come together and be in a Bible study for a short period of time, 4 weeks, 6 weeks, or whatever. What we're moving to now with life groups, I really think, is a foundation that can move for generations to come. And, you know, I just am going to invite you to look around this room and just look at the age of the people in the group. Not that I'm saying too much about that, but young Timothy here is really the only one that's represented in his generation, of his era. And so we want to change that. We need to bring people along. We need to be preparing for the future in a way that reaches out to people and will continue to reach out to people for a long, long time. The reason life groups in this format will do that is because it's about relationships. We need them at any generation of our lives. Any season of our life, we have to be connected with one another. That is so important and so essential for our life in Christ. We need to now share that with more and more people, and that's what this is all about, is helping people be in relationship with one another, to walk with each other through life in a number of different ways. I'm going to have us take a look at now, actually, just some of the basics of our Christian life, because really these are things that are essential to now a group leader. We're asking you to take a look at being a group leader and what that might mean as part of this this life group movement that we're talking about here. And really, this is nothing new. This is stuff that came straight out of our small catechism. So this is just a good review, okay? It's a review for all of us, and I'm going to grab this microphone here so that I can turn this way. Basically, that God loves you. And as you consider your leadership, can you say yes to all of these things? And I know all of you can because you say it every day when you gather together here. But you know that God loves you, that you're a sinner. Pastor Allman was talking about how, as good Lutherans, we dwell a lot on that. But you know what? We're not going to stop right here on number two, realizing that we're a sinner and that we need to confess that. We understand that God needs to punish that sin. And that means if we're a sinner, that punishment falls on us. But Jesus took that punishment, the one that we deserve, bore that on his shoulders, but didn't stay in the midst of the sin that we put on his shoulders. He died, paid the price. This is the best part. Didn't stay dead. He rose again. And because of that, he offers forgiveness of sins and eternal life to those of us who believe that. It's free. It's a gift of God. Not anything you did, because our sin sent him to the cross. He's the one that made it right. And now we get that salvation that is ours through Jesus Christ. That's what we believe as leaders here in life groups at Bethlehem. We bring that up just to remind you that that's the essence, that's the core of what we teach and believe here at Bethlehem, and the extension of our ministry really goes around that as a leader. That's what we're professing into the lives of our groups. That faith that we believe, that faith that we know, and that faith that we live because of what Christ did for us. How awesome is that, that now we get to share that with others. As we get into kind of the nuts and bolts of small groups here, life groups, there are three kinds of groups. So I'd like you to be thinking, as you're kind of formulating what a group would look like in your world, is it a service group, is it a Bible study group, or is it a common interest group? And if you read down to the next line there, you'll see that each one of those connects to our pillars of ministry here at Bethlehem. Our mission at Bethlehem is that as many people as possible will be experiencing the fullness of life in Christ. We do that through three pillars of ministry. We do it through worship, discipleship, and relationships. Life groups encompasses all of that. And that's why this soft rollout, as we're calling it, is just an introduction, and we expect to go full bore in the fall, giving everyone an opportunity to be a part of a life group, because we believe it's so important to experience worship together, discipleship together, and relationship together, and that can happen in the context of a group. But as you look at any individual group, they will all have a different primary focus. And so service may be one, And so let me just lift up some examples, because I know some of the things that you're thinking. Dean, would you mind sharing what your group, what you're thinking about for your group? You're getting guys together?
Oh, the service group?
Yeah.
Having a group that can serve in maybe three ways, depending on what people want to do, serving their time and talents, including their professional talents, attorneys, engineers, carpenters, whatever, to either people within our own church community or the church itself,
right,
to do physical things for the church itself, two, for the church community, if you're comfortable doing that, and three, to people outside our community, like our friends at the table or even the community at large. If you're willing to donate, say you're an attorney and you're willing to donate 10 hours a month to help some woman with some issue she has, or whatever talent you happen to have, or seniors, driving seniors to doctor's appointments,
yep,
babysitting some woman's kids, so she can go to work, whatever your talents are, and however you want to do them, because some people are comfortable with some things and some aren't comfortable with others. So I was thinking of having three different kind of pots, and mm-hmm, you could be on all three or any one, or however you want to do it.
Awesome. Beautiful example of a service group. Okay, and Dean has obviously been thinking about this for a while. It's pretty well formulated in his mind. We have internal service groups already at Bethlehem. And so those are the ministry areas that some of you are involved in. There's Altar Guild. Anne here works with Altar Guild. That's a life group, really, when you think about it. Those are people that come together around some area of service. But what happens when you come together around that area of service? You share life together. You know the stories of the people that you're meeting with that are coming together to prepare the altar for worship. Okay? That's a service life group. There's lots of opportunities to do that. It connects to worship because it's the giving and receiving of God's gifts. It's our spiritual act of worship, but just living out our life in our response and to love, the love of Jesus Christ. Bible study is another branch. I'm going to have, who does a Bible study group around here? Larry, you've done Bible study small groups. You've done a couple in your home, haven't you? Yeah. Dalen does Bible study small group. Number of people here have participated in them. Lifelight groups, Bible study small groups, okay? That connects to discipleship, where we're becoming more like Jesus. Okay, we study to become more like Jesus and look more like him. So we'll have Bible study groups that just have Bible study as their primary emphasis, but they'll be worshiping and they'll be in relationship with one another, because what happens when you get together? You share life together. Okay. Common interest groups, that is connected to the relationship pillar. And so the relationship pillar, the primary focus is gathering around a particular interest. So we've got the men's groups that have done golfing. We've got sports groups, rock climbing, hiking, those kinds of things, where people come together, share because of their common interest, share life together. You learn stories, you learn about each other, you become involved in each other's lives, you get to talk about who Christ is to you in the midst of that common interest. So those are the three types of life groups that we are going to be looking at.
You know, it gives a message where we at the church can sometimes be, well, that's not the way we've done it here. And I'll tell you what, Bethlehem is not that type of a place, to be quite honest with you. We are willing to take, as a congregation at large, we are willing to take risks to reach out and share the love of Jesus and make disciples for him. And that's a beautiful, beautiful thing. And this is one of those risks, right? There's a little bit of risks for you guys thinking about inviting folks into your home, doing something a little outside of the box. You've never done it that way, Bethlehem. But God is going to be blessed, and you are going to be a blessing to others as you answer his call. So we are going to move in here just with a couple. We're going to talk about, Sandy, you take the, here we go. Eight characteristics. What makes a life group? There we go. We're going to seek fullness of life in Jesus. Eight characteristics of a life group. One, they meet regularly, preferably weekly. We are going to have quarters for our life groups. So this is one thing, especially in my generation, that throws you off a little bit from the small group movement. Say you join a group. You're in this group, and you're like, how in the world am I ever going to get out? And if I get out, they're going to be very mad at me for leaving the group. I mean, this was my interest and passion, but now my interests and passions have moved on somewhere else, right? We have quarters, so you have easy entrance and exit into all of these groups without giving offense to anybody as your interests and passions change. As a leader, if you want to start up one group now and it didn't go as well and you hear the Spirit's calling to start another group, you're going to have the freedom to do that here. And you're not in this for life, if you will, okay? It's just simple 10 to 12-week quarters. And they will meet during those quarters regularly, preferably weekly. They have three or more people attending regularly, including the leader. They develop and identify a co-leader. The primary goal for us here at Bethlehem, and I know this sounds like utopia or something like that, but seriously, is that every person here at Bethlehem would see as their God-felt calling, a Spirit-led calling to be a life group leader, to lead others in their 100-foot circles that extend outside of these walls. Yeah, wow, that's pretty cool. Each meeting includes one or more of the following: Bible study, prayer, worship, and faith stories. Now, some of these groups are like common interest groups. It's a golf group. Are you going to be out there and you're on the eighth tee and you're going to pull out, hey, let's get into John here? No, it's nothing like that. But there will be faith stories being shared as people get to know you, and you have the opportunities, the Spirit leads to say, hey, there's this Jesus guy. I want you to hear about him in a normal, casual way. I mean, the way evangelism goes today isn't, it's not as confrontational, if you will. People don't respond as well, especially my generation, to somebody on the street who they have no idea. They don't know this guy or gal from Adam. And coming up and saying, hey, do you know you're a sinner? Do you know that you're going to hell without Jesus? That's a tough sell these days. Now, some folks, that may work. But our goal here is, one, to develop relationships with people in a normal, casual atmosphere, and then be able to share Jesus. So what type of group is going to most, where are we going to see this happen the most? It's probably those common interest groups, as you have passion and you invite people from your community who you know don't know Jesus, and you're praying. I mean, that's your spiritual dimension to your group. You're praying for that person on a regular basis, and you're looking for an opportunity to share Jesus with them. So one of these following, one or more of Bible study, prayer, worship, or faith stories will present itself, depending on the dynamics there within your individual group. Unless otherwise specified, these groups welcome new people into the group at any time during the semester. We want to be a welcoming body, and a lot of these common interest groups will lend themselves toward being open to new members at any time. Each life group leader will be supported and empowered by zone leaders. I shared with you that. This is a neat system of accountability we're going to have here. They also encourage members to invite people in their 100-foot circles of influence to come see what God is doing in the midst of that group. And the groups, like I said at the very beginning, may be time-limited based on quarters, but friendships will certainly continue beyond that. Any questions regarding the characteristics of life groups? Sound good? Sound hunky-dory? Yeah, Larry. Yeah, they're based on quarters. We're going to be starting up our first wave, our soft rollout of life groups on April 19th. So a week or so after Easter, a couple weeks after Easter. And these groups then are going to go on until sometime in June, I believe. It's a 10-week to 10-week quarter. So we're not asking you. You'll evaluate your groups then, and if the group is going well and they would like to continue meet on a regular basis, once the summer quarter starts, and you'll be able to pick right back up with that. But you don't have to. And we're not, as your passion changes and you see another need in your 100-foot circle, you can jump on board and do that as well. Does that make sense? Very, very good. Yeah. Oh, yeah, absolutely. All of our Bible studies right now, including the Bible studies on Sunday morning, are going to come under the Bible study life group model. So there will be zone leaders for these individual life group leaders. And some of you that have a Bible study passion that is deeply upon your heart, that you want to invite probably Christians, probably believers, maybe from here, maybe from other churches, to be a part of that group. Yes, there will be Bible study life groups within these time-based quarters. But they can extend. I mean, your curriculum, if it ends, I'm trying to speak to where your concern is, but yeah.
Common interest,
yeah.
Golf or something,
right.
They wouldn't necessarily have a Bible study.
No, the spiritual dimension to that group will shape itself as the leader sees fit. I mean, initially there may not be even prayer. We don't want to disguise our groups, be kind of secretive as to this being a Bethlehem endeavor. Does that make sense? So as you invite, hey, I got a group of guys from our church. We get together on a consistent basis. This is a friend of yours from church. I'm using the golf example. Do you want to come and you know, play around 18 with us? We just like to get to know you better. Whatever. You like golf, right? So he comes out. And during that time out, you know this guy is foreign. Anything Christian, prayer, those types of things are a little foreign to this guy. So you may wait for some more natural expressions of faith. But you, on an individual leader level, are praying for this person on a consistent basis. Obviously, you are. You wouldn't have asked him out in your life group. So we don't want to camouflage these groups. But to speak to a Bible study group, most of our Bible study groups are going to be for members here at Bethlehem. And you're going to invite the people that want to study what you want to study, your passion in God's Word at that time, and you're going to get after it. So there will be, in some of those Bible study groups, yes, prayer. You'll probably start your time off with prayer. You may worship, may sing a song or two, whatever. A lot like we do with our Lifelight. If you've come to Lifelight, been a part of that, that is a Bible study life group, a big Bible study life group, with lots of smaller groups getting together so people can develop significant relationships. Is that, am I not touching on it, or? Okay, very good. Please. We can help you, and that's what the zone leader's for. If you got some kind of, you say you want to study Job, and I don't know what a good curriculum is out there in Job. I don't know what a good curriculum is out there in Job, but the zone leader's going to help you do a little research and figure that out for you, teaming up with you. So that's why this kind of a structure of leadership is going to be very beneficial to moving these groups forward. Sandy.
Let me just comment on that a little bit further. Our resource library over by the coffee house really has shifted emphasis from family ministry resource to just ministry resources. And the gal who is running that, her name is Tara Wolf, can help order materials for you. So if you are wondering even where to get a Bible study or you're interested in a particular topic, we just need to tell her and she'll do some of the research. She can order two or three different samples. You can review them and use that material if you'd like. And then we'll keep it in the library. And then there's some over there as well.
I was asked by several people, are we still going to have pastor-led Bible studies Sunday morning?
That is a good question. As of now, yes, we're still going to have Pastor Anderson, the one big Sunday morning pastor-led Bible study, which Pastor Anderson right now is leading. And that may fluctuate. Maybe Pastor Languish will be able to get in there. Right now he's leading 915, obviously. So, yeah, Pastor Anderson is going to keep going with that one big pastor-led Bible study. But, you know, we got a lot of other capable teachers around here that can teach God's Word. So, you know, we're looking to expand our Bible study groups. John.
How did the existing Bible studies fit into the plan as far as quarterly? Because we've kind of gone our way.
All right, your men's group, you guys are Lone Rangers for Jesus. I love it. But you guys are so, I mean, you have your own structure, your own accountability group there. We're probably going to put you in, is it your group an open group? What you would call an open group. So we're going to put it on the block. We're going to get you to fill out a lot of your information, saying what your group is all about, and we're going to put it on the block as a men's Bible study group that meets on Friday morning, really, really early. Come, come. It's great. It's awesome. And but we will also, last thing, we'll also resource you within a zone leader to assist you in accountability, just to check in with you, John, on a consistent basis, say, hey, how's it going? You guys are probably okay, but it's probably just to let you know that you are connected to the bigger ministry here at Bethlehem. You're not just doing this all by yourself. Yeah.
There
you go. Just continue on the same way. Yeah. Sandy, correct me if I'm wrong. Do we have a couple months break? I think we do.
Well, we're going to run two sessions this summer, yeah. And a hard rollout in the fall.
And then a hard rollout in the fall.
But I think around Christmas, there's a break.
Yeah, there's a good break. Okay. I got to look at our calendar. I don't have that right now. But like I say, the big, big push, and you guys are going to be kind of our ambassadors for life groups as you get out there and experience these this spring. The big push is going to be in the fall, where our expectation is for God's people here at Bethlehem to be in a life group, if not lead a life group, God willing. Dean.
Will each life group, if they want to have a section or whatever on the block so that we can direct people, let's say, for example, with the health thing that I was talking about earlier, if you're interested, we can just tell the person, you know, check this out on the block and go to this tab. Or we meet somebody on the street who needs help. Go to bethruth.net and click on the IDHealth tab and find our people? Will we be able to do that?
Yes, is the short answer, but Sue is going to give you a little bit longer answer regarding
just
that.
Make sure I'm coming. There is a public version of the groups, meaning that the block, the sign-in, is only for Bethlehem people or people involved in our groups. But if you want to search for an open group, let's say you're just the public, we'll have that on our website, and then each group will have a description, and there'll be a link to contact the leader, a link to request to join, and those kinds of things.
So you got some flexibility and some ways for you to build things that we might need built?
Well, the block now, it's already built, meaning that that's part of the functionality built in there, that I can, on our website, list all the groups that are listed and descriptions of those groups. So that someone who's just Joe, anybody, can at least contact the leader and learn a little bit about it. Then once they join the group, then obviously they would get a login username and be part of your group.
Is that answering your question?
Yes, sir, but I can talk to you later about
the details. Okay, very good, very good. But yes, groups will be on the block and easily accessible for everyone. Yeah.
I just want to, hopefully we have another get together to talk about that, because I've been on and I've tried doing searches for other people similar interests, and I can't get it to
work. We're going to spend some time with
well,
that
just,
today.
Well, just the brief answer to that is, if you can't find a person, they haven't listed themselves in their privacy. I will be starting to send out emails and encouraging people to list themselves, otherwise you're not going to see anything. You don't see the public groups yet because we haven't really started this off with the list of public groups. But that's the quick answer.
And
we'll set
that's
some up
it.
Today.
Yeah, most we don't have a lot of people that have probably signed on yet.
We've had about 200 requests.
Yeah, once we do, I just think, you know, for us, if you want to be a leader, you want to see people that you can try to bring into your life group. So, yeah, that right now I'm still struggling on how to capture that information.
We're going
to
be, we'll put your group up on the block. And as
this is where the information is, where you find out about life groups, people are obviously, oh, I need to be on the block. I need to get on there. I need to list myself and do all those types of things. And once they do, I mean, it's going to be a process, Brett, you know, as half of our congregation at least does not use a computer. So we're going to have to, we'll put together a little booklet, if you will, for all of the life groups, for people to sign up, who the leaders are, all that kind of stuff, for you to grow your group. And that's where we're meeting right now. I mean, the groups aren't starting until April 19th, and this is, what, March 1st. So you have now, as these groups get solidified, we have 6 weeks or so to start publicizing your individual groups, both on the block and in paper format as well. Does that make sense? So we're gonna explore every avenue to get these groups into the ears of people to hear about what the needs are that have been presented by y'all. All right. Any other questions? All right, let's move on real quick here. I appreciate you guys asking questions. Four do's of a life group. Like I said, Bible study, prayer, worship, faith stories. Life groups will incorporate any one or a combination of the above do's. It's just what we talked about a second ago. Four don'ts of a life group. We'd rather not they be used for business purposes. No offerings will be taken for individual life groups. If you guys are doing something that needs to be funded, obviously you'll just pay for it yourself, whatever that would be in a common interest group. The church won't pay for a free round of golf. I know, drag. Unapproved speakers, no unapproved speakers. If you're bringing somebody into your group to share, just contact Sandy or I, and if it's kosher, we'll give you the stamp of approval. Make contacts, and don't make contacts on behalf of Bethlehem Lutheran Church. For business purposes. And our concerns there is a danger and a little bit of a liability to Bethlehem's ministry. Does that make sense as we explore these? Because you are representing Bethlehem, and you're an extension of us here as the body of Christ. Yeah.
Do you have a list of qualifications or restrictions on unapproved speakers?
Not necessarily yet. I mean, it's probably going to be right now. I don't know how many unapproved or speakers you're going to be bringing into your individual small groups, life groups. But just on a case-by-case basis, I'd assume we'd go and explore who these folks are. Do any false teachers. I mean, I don't even have a good example as to who this unapproved speaker would be. But just if you're bringing anybody in to share on a one-time basis, just let us know. And most likely we'd put it, yeah, that sounds good. But yeah, just get it approved. Yeah.
Well, we usually have a speaker like in our potluck. We have to have
all those who's your leader? Which potluck?
Prime timers.
Well, you have leaders there. No. I mean, you have leaders there that are a part of this ministry. It's not necessary. I mean, that's a bigger group. So I think we're good. That is a good question. absolutely. So I think that's the end of my time. Sandy, I want to continue. Two questions. Yes. No. Absolutely. I mean, you just need to check on the block. We have our calendaring system and make requests on the block. It's really easy to do. Make requests for usage of various space. And then Ms. Kim Musselman right back here will give you, yep, that's good. And if there's some conflict, then she'll say, no, you got to find another spot. So, yeah.
Could you expand on the business don'ts? What is that including?
We want this to be a spiritual gathering where people are coming together to get to know each other. We don't want to, because it's probably a turnoff for folks if you're coming there and, oh, this guy's just trying to get me to buy whatever it is at his business. And that's kind of what we want to stay away from. And this is seeking to be the hands and feet of Jesus. We're not trying to sell anything else but Jesus.
If the group is all
businessmen,
is trying to help
each other,
with, like, you know,
and I would say that's being the hands and feet of Jesus.
It's not a bar. Right, but if all of us sales guys got together and said, hey, how do we better network for better sale? Obviously, the more money I save my clients, the more money they can give to God.
Right.
And that's a fact. But if I've talked to four or five guys and said, yeah, we don't do anything here about that part of fellowship, and that's a major part of biblical fellowship, is helping each other. And so
I don't think there's anything wrong with that type of networking. No.
Yeah, let me speak to that a little bit, because this has been a guideline that's been a part of our small group ministry since 20 years ago. And we've found it to be very necessary, and I'll tell you why. I don't know if any of you have been a part of a group where all of a sudden you get connected with that group and you get invited to every home party and you get asked to purchase things that you feel obligated maybe to look at because of this group that you're a part of. That's the kind of thing that we're trying to protect against. And I think that's different than what you're suggesting. If the group is designed to be about encouraging and supporting each other in their business endeavors, then that is a life group. Go do it, and do it to the glory of God, and make it happen. But what we're trying to do is protect people from their name being on a distribution list, our church membership database not ever being used for that, or even your small group being used for that. That, you know, you bring your brochure of the latest thing that you're selling or the latest thing that is a part of your life. Now, does that mean you don't talk about your business? No, of course not. In the course of your life, when you're sharing life together, you talk about what you do. And that's different. That's just in the common course of everyday conversation. So this piece is an important piece, but it is to protect us and our members from being solicited because of the ministry. And that's what we want to guard against, you know. And my best example is my mom. My mom calls me about 10 years ago and says, oh, I just got involved in this phone marketing thing, phone calling cards, and you save money. It was big 10 years Excel, I think it was called, or something like that. And it would be great to have everybody in your church do it, because after all, it saves money. And, you know, she had this whole laundry list of things, and I had to say to my own mother, we don't do that kind of thing, you know, because that's not the primary purpose. That's not why we're here. Okay, so it comes up more often than you like, but I've also been thanked more often than not for having that kind of protection in our small group. So that's why it's out there as a don't. We're going to move on to confidentiality in the midst of a group, because that's another thing that becomes very important to protect in the context of a group. When people are together and we start to share and start to understand more about each other's lives, things come up that might be considered confidential. And we want to remember that in the context of a group, we want to maintain those confidences. We do not want to share what has been shared in the context of the group with somebody on Sunday morning, even if you think that it's okay. The only time that you can is if you ask for permission. So here's an example of that. Very often people will say, well, I'm having surgery. You know, you learn that in the context of your group or whatever. And it is not, as a leader, it is not your responsibility to share that information with anybody. If you feel that the church should know that, then you would say to the person, may I share that with our pastors? They give you permission, you call the church and let us know what's going on. Prayer requests also come up in that context. Just because somebody has said, I'm having surgery, may not automatically mean that you're going to report it to the church so that it can be on the church prayer list. You also, for that reason, want to ask the person, may I share it with the church? Okay? Unless the person has said this is public information, it remains in the confidence of the group. Okay? Again, I don't know if you've ever been a part of a group where you've shared something, and on Sunday morning, someone that you didn't share it with asks you about it. It's like, whoa, how did that get around? You know, that's what we're trying to guard against here with confidentiality. The integrity of a group really can be compromised when we're not caring for one another in a way that keeps confidentiality in place. Now, there are some exceptions when we need to breach that. And that's when there's difficult situations in the group that come up where there is harm that is being done to someone or to oneself. And those are things that we're asking in the context of a group for you to talk with your zone leader and to know that you don't have to bear any of these burdens by yourself, ever. We do not want you to feel like you have to deal with any of these kinds of situations that are very, very difficult, and they will come up in the context of your group because everybody has a story and everybody has something that's difficult. So things will come up. These kinds of things need to be talked with someone else, not only because it's a risky kind of situation, but we have so many resources here to help support people. And we want to get people connected with the right resources. We also don't want you to bear these things by yourself, to carry the weight of some of these things by yourself. So we do ask you, in the cases of an allegation or a suspicion of child abuse, threats of harm to oneself or to another person, where there's mental illness situations, depression, that kind of thing, and when there's illegal anything going on, not just substance abuse, illegal anything, we want you to be sure to talk with someone about that so that we can handle those situations. Yes?
Letting that person know that we would be discussing it with this one.
Absolutely, absolutely. In those kinds of situations, you would say, I am obligated to share this information with my zone leader. And so sometimes you want to tell people that, you know, if they're going down a path and you're feeling uncomfortable with the information, you might want to say that up front. I need to let you know that I may need to share this with someone. Okay? Yeah. And our role in life groups is not to be a counselor. It isn't to handle these kinds of situations. Our role is to share life together with one another, to encourage one another, and that's why we want you to get the resources you need if these kinds of situations come up. Make sense? Yeah.
By someone, do you really want to share that with them before you talk to the zone leader?
If you personally are being threatened, yeah, you may not even want to go to a zone leader. You may want to call the cops. I mean, it depends on the nature of the threat. Yeah, yeah. You need to take the appropriate action to protect yourself. Yeah. And you know what? If there is a threat that you feel like sharing with the person would increase that risk of threat, then don't. Yeah. Don't let them know. Just get the help you need. Yeah, absolutely. Other questions? A couple of things on qualifications now for our life group leaders. And they're all just listed right here. Sincere, worthy of respect, a good reputation. That you've spent a little time here at Bethlehem, maybe a year or so, and give regularly to the church. We said tithe here, but I think you're actively committed to the church. Worship and Bible study, probably first and foremost before this, that you're growing closer to Jesus Christ. Those are, a tithe is an outward manifestation of your relationship with Christ, so that's just one listed there. Having a genuine desire to serve and to minister to others, able to facilitate and motivate other people, and able to create positive group dynamics within the context of a group are some of the things that we're looking for. As we move ahead now into the next step, we're going to take a look at where do we go from here. And I think, Tim, are you going to talk about this, or am I going to talk about this? I'm going to talk about this? Okay. Oh, okay, one more slide. Go ahead.
Before we move, for our life groups, what resources at the church are available to us, like to help promote life groups? Is it just going to be the block, or what other things can we do?
Yeah. You can utilize any resources of the church, but the whole organization will be promoted through the good news, through our regular avenues of communication. Like Pastor Allman said, there will be a catalog, a listing of all the life groups every quarter, and you'll be able to search them on the block. But definitely the team that is working with life groups is paying attention to how to get that information into people's hands. Definitely, yeah.
This year, I think it was enormously beneficial that when we started the group, we got something in writing, and that every new member that comes in gets it, and so it doesn't get ahead of them, because sometimes somebody can share something, or go to a place where something's out on the table, and it was meant to be confidential, but it can be, or it's not going to be. So if you have it in writing, like you have an agreement or something where everybody knows what's expected as far as confidentiality, if something's going to be confidential, you state that before you share it.
Yeah.
And the abuse thing also has come up where you say, we can't keep certain things confidential. So the person, so it's known ahead of time.
Yeah, absolutely, which is a good point in just about anything with your group, to, from the get-go, talk about how you're going to operate together, how you're going to operate with one another, how you're going to function. We'd call that a covenant or an agreement with group members. And so you're going to talk about what are expectations around attendance and bringing your suites, like our video demonstrated. What are the expectations so that everybody knows that? But then also getting into some of the specifics, like discussion items and how they will be handled. We've gone so far as to have a written agreement with groups, and then everybody signs it. And then every time somebody new comes into the group, you want to revisit it so that everybody's on the same page. We do that in LifeLight. If you've participated in LifeLight, that's a common pattern for that. So yeah, good point, John. Thank you. What we're going to do now is a couple of things. We're going to actually have you gather together around a couple of tables. We don't have specific zone leads right now. Pastor Allman and I are serving in that function until we go to the big rollout. But Steve Wade and Lois Anderson, where's Lois? Right here, are going to be assisting us in this process. And what a zone leader does basically is helps you identify maybe what your group might look like. And then start to develop that group. And so I'm going to have Pastor Allman is going to work maybe over in this corner, and he is going to be working with groups that are service-oriented.
And common interests.
Let's do lowest common interests.
Oh, right, yeah.
Why don't you do service?
Service.
Steve is going to do discipleship, so any of the Bible study ones. I'll do internal service. You can do external service kinds of groups. So we're going to have you move to the kind of group that you're basically thinking about, and we'll have some discussion about that. If you do, you want me to define that for you? Internal service would be if you're interested in starting a group that is related to or formalizing a group that is a part of our ministry at Bethlehem. So that would be any of our organizations or groups that provide a service to the ministry here, or a new service that hasn't yet been started, like Dean's would probably. Dean has kind of a component of both. So it doesn't really matter. We don't want to get bogged down in this order of things, but his it would be internal and external. External service is if you want to get involved in Main Street Ministry.
Habitat,
any kind of community service organization. You want to do a mission trip to Biloxi. Probably this summer I'm going to do an external life group for 10 weeks. I'm going to choose a place where I want to do a mission project. I'll just advertise it, see who wants to go with me, kind of like how we did Biloxi when we've been down there. See who wants to go down, maybe there, maybe somewhere else. And that's going to be my life group for 10 weeks. That's an external service project. If I'm going to continue teaching FPU, Financial Peace University, that's going to be an internal, probably kind of ministry, and I'm probably going to put it under...